Ubiquity means we're everywhere at once. Ubiquity, in this family we are one.
I say good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Welcome everyone to our event today. It's called Bigger Than Boundaries. Let me introduce myself. My name is Alfred Burks, and I'm a member of Ubiquity Incorporated. Ubiquity is Howard's oldest African-centered organization on campus that has three specific pillars. Strengthening bonds between black men and black women, also community service, and lastly, academic excellence, because we are student activists here at Howard University. We also practice the seven principles of Nguza Saba, and that's also another dynamic of the organization. I want to get straight to the point. We have a very packed program. I know everyone came here to hear Dr. Gerald Horne actually talk about some of the work that he's been doing, and also some of the literature that he's produced recently, and some of the stuff that's actually coming out that will be published within this next month. So why are we here today? The purpose of today's event is to get students like us, community members also, to talk about issues beyond our national boundaries. Oftentimes, we can operate as if the issues that impact us socially, economically, are within our city boundaries, within our state boundaries, and within our national boundaries. However, Dr. Horne will shed a little bit more light on the history of African Americans understanding the international perspective in a struggle against oppression. So, without further ado, I actually want to bring up Dr. Gregg Carr. From the African American Studies Department, who also co-sponsored this event. And I also give thanks to everyone who helped make sure this event was successful, including NAMO, Speakers Bureau, KTS, Kwame Ture Society, which comes out of the African American Studies Department. So without further ado, I want to introduce Dr. Gregg Carr.
This won't take but a second. Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
We have some, folks will be coming in. A number of students are coming. It's Friday night, so you know it's really, people know why they're here, because it's Friday night. Otherwise, you know, ain't just one nothing. Like, nobody here wandered in here. Everybody knows why they're here. They're here to hear the brother to your left. We've been joined by folks, and I'm right at the beginning. Dr. Lachlan Lynch is here, I think he's a pioneer in the study of African people globally, and it's good to see you, brother. And any number of people, I was as surprised as any, I guess, and thank you, Skip Ada, for really making this possible, because when I looked in and saw that Robert Rhodes had come in, Dr. Bob Rhodes is one of the legendary figures in the political analysis of global events. And we've also been joined by our brother who is directly responsible for bringing some of the names that we know here at Howard, Ron Walters, Joyce Ladner, Robert Hill, a number of people, and that would be Dr. Andrew Billingsley, who has come into the room. Dr. Billingsley is here. So we're all here to hear a humble, relentless, brilliant brother. And a hard-working brother, a brother whose work is incessant. And in many ways, I'll put it this way, you know, people talk about ranking and all this kind of thing, they won't do that, but I would say that as far as in my limited opinion, there's no more important thinker producing work today than this brother right here, Dr. Gerald Horne. We could talk about his 30 plus books, his work when he was executive director of the National Conference of Black Lawyers. This is a brother who actually went to the trial of Walter Rodney and just talks about it incidentally. This is a guy involved in the anti-apartheid struggle at a very deep level. We can talk about his service, his commitment. You know, oftentimes people ask him to come places and he says, no, whatever you're gonna spend on my plane ticket or lodging, take that money and plow it back into the organization. This is an organizer. But I'm not going to talk long because we came to hear Dr. Horne. I will say that the last time I guess you were in this room, Brother Gerald, was when you spoke at the Moreland Spingarn Conference. The Morning Spingarn Conference in January, Dr. Williams is here, Dana Williams, who co-chaired that committee, who brought together the Morning Spingarn Conference here, spoke from this stage on the importance of archival research, January 2010. It really sparked a rebirth of the Morning Spingarn concept here at Howard, leading to directly to the appointment of Dr. Howard Dotson as the director of Morning Spingarn. We want to thank you for that. We've also been joined by the Dean Emeritus of the College of Arts and Sciences, Dr. James Donaldson. He's kind of trying to sneak in the back, but I'm going to let him do that. Serious room tonight, I'm just letting you know, man. But in the remarks that he gave that day, based on an article he published in the Journal of African American History on the importance of archival research, a transnational research agenda for the 21st century, Dr. Horne reminded us that it is primary research and archival research that will carry the day. And so, I hope you will indulge just a couple of minutes, not long, but they're particularly for the young people here, and I recognize just about all the young people here, mostly Howard students, who, and these are some of the most serious students we have at the university, of the 10,000 plus we have, the folks who will come out tonight. And as I told you on the way over here, some of them have been reading your books since they found out you were coming. They went and got even more of your books. Gerald said, yeah, I don't know if I've read all the books, but that's all you would do is read your books if you start. So just let me mention, and this isn't all the books, but just to give you a sense, for a man not only to be a practicing lawyer, but to move out of that world, to come into the world, to begin to produce out of his doctoral dissertation, I think it was your doctoral dissertation, Black and Red, 1986, State University of New York Press, Black and Red, a rereading of Du Bois and a linking him to the tradition, the deep tradition of radical intellectual work, to follow that, and all this while he's working now, as chair of Black Studies at the University of California, Santa Barbara, to be barrel of a gun, dealing with Zimbabwe, to deal with, in fact, I'll put them in chronological order because I remember them having read them, but it trips me out every time I reassemble the list. The Thinking and Rethinking U.S. History, a lot of people don't know that Dr. Horne edited a manuscript and a piece that dealt with the question of textbooks in American history and the importance of textbooks in American history and dealing with it differently. Communist Front, the Civil Rights Congresses, you know, when Negroes were organizing and with a little bit more freedom in their mind, maybe a little bit more transnational liberation. Studies in Black, that he published a series of essays that capture some of the work that he'd been doing in the 1970s and 80s. The small book on affirmative action, the case for affirmative action. We probably need to reread that in the era of Fisher versus Texas. Black Liberation Red Scare, the new book on William Patterson, follows in the footsteps of earlier profiles of folks like Ben Davis of New York. And I could go on and on and on, but I will just mention a couple of others. And this is where I think in terms of Dr. Horne, and we basically, it's going to be, this is the format. Get your questions ready, get your comments ready, and let's have a free-for-all. This is being taped. This is Ada's back there on the tape. Dr. Horne likes to make sure this is available to the widest possible audience, and what we have the opportunity to do tonight is something that is very rare, particularly in the university setting, to engage a scholar who is thinking past the conventional kind of logics with other folks in the room who have done similarly to really get deeper into this question of how we as Black people, we as human beings, get free. Over the last maybe the last 20 years, Dr. Horne has been unfolding this project that seems to be coming together in the footnotes and in the ending pages of his more recent books. This large project that looks at the last several centuries as part of a bigger kind of political economy. So when you see works like Race War, when he's dealing with this question of Japan becoming a champion of so-called colored races and how African people in this country are responding to that and elsewhere. When you see a book like Black and Brown, where he's dealing with the African presence in the United States and how that connects to Spanish-speaking communities such as Mexico. When you see treatments such as Red Seas, when you're dealing with Ferdinand Smith and the question of Black unions, the most important Black union leader of his time, somebody deported here out of the United States, out of the Caribbean. And then echoing into a set of books that came out like a double-barrel shotgun, The Deepest South, that deals with Brazil and the Confederacy and how this thing continued well beyond the end of the Civil War in the United States. And then The White Pacific, dealing with how Hawaii gets pulled into this concept of blackbirding and how plantation slavery continues. A story that he continues in a book, Fighting in Paradise. Looking at the Longshoremen's Union and how what was really deep racism and fascism in Hawaii gets displaced by a unified labor movement, which kind of envies into Barack Obama in some ways, as Frank Marshall Davis is there, who is seen as the father, we laugh about that, of Barack Obama, the right wing thinks, but that evokes yet another title, Mau Mau in Harlem. And I could go on, which talks about how the United States and Kenya have this relationship, and the United States in part trying to suppress revolutionary movements, and Kenya been participating in that. In some ways sends part of their elite here to be trained, including Barack Obama Sr. His most recent book that we have access to, although in 2 weeks that's going to be displaced by the book on William Patterson. The book that's for sale on the table out there, Negro Comrades of the Crown. African Americans and the British fight the United States before emancipation. Dr. Horne is intentionally provocative in his work, but he's intentionally provocative because he can back it up with the archival research. So the sentiment that all black people wanted was liberation and they would do whatever they needed to do to get it is expressed in every page of that book. And as he ends that book, in the last paragraph of the book, you see him begin to pull these threads together. How the question of internationalism, the relationship of African people in this country to people elsewhere, not just black people, but people, nation states, political leaders, people with agendas that may or may not have been in alignment with what black people wanted, are all pulled together for the greater purpose of Africans and others struggling for liberation. He ends that book, Negro Comrades of Crown, on that point, and then does something that he doesn't often indulge himself in doing, but I'm glad he did it. Cite himself. To put himself in the place now to walk across the bridge to the next series of books, I think two or three of which are already written, and the publishers, I don't think the publishers can publish fast enough as this man can write. Finally, Josh Myers, Dr. Myers and I, who own Valley here at Howard, were in Atlanta in February of this year. There was a conference on W.E.B. Du Bois. 3 days of talking about Du Bois. Talking about Du Bois is important, so you can imagine a lot of souls of black folk talk, a lot of double conscience and talented ten talk, this kind of thing. On Du Bois's, the anniversary of his birth, on his birthday, February 23rd, this man stood up and in 10 minutes rewrote the DNA of the entire conference by saying that basically, since Du Bois is passing to now, we have, what'd you call it? A lost era led by a lost generation of scholars who have basically made a truce. You know, I'm gonna stop right there. You know why? Because you didn't come to hear me talk, you came to hear this man talk, and he's about to walk through all of that and more, so please join me and join us, Ubiquity. Thank you so much in welcoming the incomparable Dr. Gerald Horne.
Thank you very much for that introduction. I appreciate it. And thank you to Ubiquity, particularly Albert Burks III and his comrades in Ubiquity for helping to sponsor this event along with Afro-American Studies. Thanks to Skip Bailey in the back and Ada Babina at the camera for helping to bring me here. And also, of course, thanks to Howard University. I mean, for me, coming to Howard University is like coming to Mecca. I mean, it's an honor. To be here at Howard University, particularly amongst young people, because for my generation, Howard University historically and actually has been considered the capstone of black education, particularly in North America. And so it's an honor to be with you this evening. My talk is going to be rather extemporaneous. I usually like to speak with a prepared text because it's easier. But I'm going to speak extemporaneously and discursively to a degree off the cuff because I'm basically going to talk about some of my work and some of my ongoing projects. And part of my purpose, hopefully, is to inspire you, young people, to seek to follow in my footsteps because despite the Google just announcing and starting this new company called Calico that's supposed to extend life eternally, I'm not sure if I'll be around by the time they get that up and running. And so somebody's going to have to continue this work, and hopefully it will be some or all of you. And perhaps in discussion, because I don't plan to speak that long, we can talk about techniques for writing, techniques for research, and all of that, how to get up and running. So let me begin by saying that, first of all, I'm just going to have a contemporary reference to this Syrian-Iran crisis as sort of an exemplar of my theme this evening, the hidden history of Black internationalism in the United States. And then I'm going to talk about some of my books and some of my future projects. And since I'm talking about stuff I've already written, I feel that I can basically reveal my themes up front rather than lead up to the themes. And these are the takeaways for you busy young people who want to know what the summary is of what I'm saying. Here are the takeaways. One theme is that, as I'm going to try to suggest with this Syrian-Iran crisis, that sadly and tragically, but ironically and predictably, some of President Obama's top supporters are missing in action with regard to the discussion of this crisis, which fortunately has calmed down in recent days because of this apparent discussion about securing alleged or actual chemical weapons of Syria. And they're missing in action because, despite the heroic status and legacy of W.E.B. Du Bois, Paul Robeson, Shirley Graham Du Bois, and a number of other past intellectuals and activists, it's very difficult nowadays, tragically and ironically, to think of any of our leaders or intellectuals who can speak cogently about some of the burning global crises of the day. And what that means, for example, with regard to the Syrian-Iran crisis, is that the discourse, therefore, is dominated by right-wing voices or voices that don't take into account the interests of Black people in the United States or working-class people generally. And I'm arguing, and what my books have argued, is that this was a predictable consequence of how and why it was that the system of apartheid in the United States, known as Jim Crow, began to crumble some decades ago. Recently in Washington, there was a lot of self-congratulation, perhaps understandably, on the 50th anniversary of the March on Washington and the I Have a Dream speech, but sadly and unfortunately lost in the conversation was the fact that when Jim Crow began to crumble, and say let's mark that from 1963, it was due to two factors that have helped to determine and shape our outcomes and our livelihood in North America ever since the first Africans began to arrive here centuries ago. What were those two factors? Well, one is obvious, the struggles of we, the people, particularly the Black people ourselves, for liberation. But the other factor is the international environment. And basically, those two factors, our struggle and the international environment, it sort of operates like chopsticks, where one is constant and stable, which is our struggles, and the other is variable, which is the international climate. And in 1963, with all of the discourse about the March on Washington, which deserves credit as an exemplar of our struggles and our determination, what was lost sight of was that in May 1963, in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia, you had the founding of the Organization of African Unity. At the same time in May 1963, you had an outburst of violence in Birmingham, Alabama, which of course did get attention a few weeks ago. But if you go back and look at the record, what you'll find is that in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia, not only were a number of Black American leaders there, including Shirley Graham Du Bois, who had recently moved to Ghana, basically lobbying the African leaders to make strong statements concerning our plight here. And that is what they proceeded to do. One after another, they trooped up to the microphone to denounce U.S. apartheid, to engage in acts of solidarity with we, the people here in North America. This was important because this was taking place in the context of a Cold War climate, the competition between the United States and the then socialist camp for hearts and minds all over the world, including in Africa. And in that context, the words of these African leaders could not be ignored. The problem was, of course, that when we came to basically erode Jim Crow, there were trade-offs. It was a negotiation. And part of the trade-offs that we made was, in retrospect, the price might have been too high. One of the trade-offs was that leaders like Paul Robeson and W.E.B. Du Bois, our most internationally minded leaders, our leaders who are most likely to try to engage in acts of solidarity with our brothers and sisters abroad, were basically marginalized, isolated, and sidelined in return for the Civil Rights Act of 1964, the Voting Rights Act of 1965, and the other examples of legislation meant to chip away at Jim Crow. And the other aspect, which I'm sure you're familiar with at Howard University, was that we had to either weaken or detonate many of our independent black institutions. I'm going to mention shortly a book that I'm working on now about the Associated Negro Press, which was in existence from 1918 to 1967. You're probably familiar with the Associated Press, which is still with us. It has correspondents all over the world. And you pick up the Washington Post or the New York Times, you see stories from this news agency from their correspondents. Well, the Associated Negro Press was an equivalent of that. Langston Hughes, Zora Neale Hurston, Richard Bright, correspondents all over the world, all over the United States. Its record is probably the most detailed and granular record of not only black life in the United States, but black life, particularly in Africa, that has ever been assembled, because they're filing stories on a daily basis. And sadly, and ironically, the Associated Negro Press, which had done so much to combat Jim Crow and combat colonialism in Africa and the Caribbean, began to crumble, just as Jim Crow and colonialism were about to crumble. And that's part of the legacy of our movement. That is to say that many of our most progressive and far-sighted leaders were isolated, like Shirley Graham Du Bois and Paul Robeson, and many of our institutions were either weakened or detonated. And it's very interesting, like many of you, I have many conversations with people in the United States, particularly black Americans who are conscious, and many of them point a finger across the Atlantic at South Africa, and they lament the negotiated settlement that led to the erosion and the collapse of apartheid. And they say that the price was too high in terms of basically achieving a certain kind of political freedom without the economic infrastructure destroyed. But here in North America, the difference there is that they recognize they had a negotiated settlement that involved painful compromises. People over here, they had a negotiated settlement too, but they tend to see it as a slam dunk victory, when actually it involved compromises. And we have yet to assess if the compromises were too significant and too profound. That's one of the charges that you younger scholars are going to have to deal with in coming decades and in this century, was whether or not a different sort of arrangement could have been worked out that it would have left us in a more advantageous position than we are today. Another point of my research that I'm going to try to unfold is that if you want to understand the United States, I think oftentimes the analogy is made to try to compare it with Britain, the former mother country. After all, we are sitting here speaking the language of Britain. But my opinion after these years of research is that the United States is better understood through the prism of African history, better understood through the prism of settler states, such as once existed in Algeria, Kenya, South Africa, and particularly Rhodesia, now known as Zimbabwe. It's no accident that Zimbabwe claims so much space in the US press when time comes to discuss Africa, because in many ways, it's the closest analogy to the history of the United States, as I will detail shortly, and we'll be publishing a book next year. Basically, Rhodesia, just north of South Africa, was a colony settled by a European minority in the 1890s. And then in 1965, as Africa was being decolonized, that is to say, these settlers had set up the state on behalf of London, and London was being forced to give up its colonies. That's the process of decolonization. So what happens is the settlers decide that they don't want to decolonize. So there's a rebellion against decolonization that attempts to establish an independent white minority regime, a separate state. And that leads to a war that leads to the independence of Zimbabwe in April 1980, where Bob Marley, you may recall, performs. The United States' birthday is oftentimes given as July 4th, 1776. But as I suggest, actually I'll pass this out now. Publishing, they still use 19th century techniques, even though we're in the 21st century. And so I'd expect some of these books to be out by now. Now I just have the covers, and they'll be out soon. But as I say in this book, The Counter-Revolution of 1776, the United States was formed in a revolt against the abolition of slavery. The United States was moving, Britain was moving towards abolishing slavery. That was the import of Somerset's case in June 1772. But this so upset the settlers, particularly the settlers across the river in Virginia, that they rose up as one to kick out the British. And I think if you understand that, you begin to understand why this country has been so conservative. You begin to understand how and why it was that the rights enshrined in the Constitution were not designed as a template that would apply to us. In fact, it was the United States, in many ways, as I say in this book, was really the first apartheid state. And just like when apartheid came to South Africa, the founding fathers of apartheid did not intend the rights extended to the Europeans to extend to the Africans. If you believe that, you should see Nelson Mandela's jailers as its liberators. But it was intended only to apply to those defined as white. And when I began this research, sometimes it's very difficult to prove a thesis that you have. But as I was telling Professor Carr, when you proved this thesis, it was like alluvial diamonds. Just pick them up off the ground. It's a very, very easy case to prove. As a matter of fact, usually, I've been giving this presentation on the 1776 book to a number of black audiences in particular. And usually when I give this presentation, I fall down on my knees and apologize. Because somebody needs to apologize. This book should not have taken 250 years for somebody to say this and to prove this case. That's so obvious. And I particularly feel badly for the victims of the United States. The United States is that rare example. Vladimir Putin of Russia got into hot water the other day for denouncing and critiquing the concept of American exceptionalism, this idea that this country is so unique. But in a sense, it is unique, because it's one of the few countries I can think of where the founders basically perpetrated genocide against the indigenous people, engaged in mass enslavement of another group, and are hailed as the paragons of virtue. That's an astonishing case. And somebody, black scholars, black radical scholars, need to apologize for not making this case, because it's led to the wounding and hurting of so many people, not to mention the slaughter of so many people, and it's still happening today. So, first of all, with regard to Syria, let me just make a few points about that, because once again, the point that I'm making is that many of the black leaders and black intellectuals are not able to speak cogently about this crisis, which therefore tips the discourse towards the right, which then leads to crisis that was barely averted recently. I noticed that when he went to St. Petersburg, Russia, President Obama sought to meet with human rights groups in Russia, sought to meet with gay and lesbian groups in Russia to express his concern. But what struck me at the time was that if Vladimir Putin came to Washington and sought to express his concern, say, about the Trayvon Martin case, where George Zimmerman was acquitted, and polling suggested that the Euro-American majority found that case acceptable and found that verdict acceptable and justifiable, which means that if we do not use our other lever, which is international solidarity, well, basically, there will be no justice with regard to not only Trayvon Martin, but the brother who just got shot in Charlotte, North Carolina, and the other brothers and sisters who are now languishing behind bars. Black people in the United States, of course, are the most incarcerated people on this planet. And what struck me is that if Vladimir Putin wanted to meet with black leaders and intellectuals to express his concern and perhaps to have a conversation, as we used to have conversations about how we can exert international pressure on the United States with regard to racism and white supremacy and moving this country forward, that many of our black leaders and intellectuals would not meet with him. Or with anybody else, for that matter, who didn't carry a U.S. passport. Because either they would not see the importance, or perhaps they'd be frightened and intimidated. And what that means is that we're stuck. It leaves us basically in pain. It's basically, the message is, well, you know, we're suffering, and get used to it. Fortunately, as some of the history I'm going to talk about suggests, the black leaders and intellectuals of the past did not necessarily take that point of view. So what I'm going to talk about now is basically some of the books that I've written and some of the themes that I'd like to underscore of these books that either need to be followed up on, either in terms of scholarship or in terms of activism. I mean, for example, Professor Carr mentioned I did a number of books on the South Seas, on Hawaii, Fighting Paradise, which deals with the labor movement in Hawaii. And I think that book is very useful for an understanding of how a person from Hawaii came to be president of the United States, because Hawaii is probably the most progressive sector of the 50 states. It has the most progressive legislation with regard to labor organizing. It has the most progressive legislation with regard to women's reproductive freedom. And in many ways, Hawaii connects with a book I'm going to talk about that I'm working on now about Haiti. Because I think the lesson of Hawaii, this once independent country that was very sophisticated and then was overthrown by the U.S. in the 1890s, is that even though it was overthrown, it still left a very remarkable progressive legacy that is still asserting itself in 2013. So I think the lesson for an organization, an individual, or a state is that you can be destroyed, but the question is, what kind of legacy are you leaving that will continue to reverberate throughout the centuries? And the same holds true for Haiti, which had a revolution 1791 to 1804, which led to a crisis of the entire slave system, including here in North America, which led directly to the collapse of that slave system. But by the 1870s, Haiti was on the verge of being annexed, taken over by the United States. Yet, despite that difficulty, despite subsequent difficulties, the fact remains that the Haitian Revolution led to the collapse of slavery. That legacy cannot be overturned. That legacy cannot be overwritten. I did also this book on the South Seas called The White Pacific, U.S. Imperialism and Black Slavery in the South Seas after the Civil War. It's talking about these slave owners in the United States. They had the Keith Sweat approach to slavery. After slavery, they wanted to make slavery last forever. And so after it was abolished in the United States in 1865, they just moved out to the South Seas and began enslaving people, Melanesian people, people who looked like yourself and myself, and Polynesian people, and then dragging them to Queensland, Australia, to the South Seas. And in fact, the Hawaiian kingdom at that time was trying to overturn that system, which was one of the reasons that the Hawaiian kingdom was overthrown. One of the footnotes in that book that would be worth following up on is that these U.S. slavers who moved out to the South Seas and were kidnapping people who looked like yourself and myself, some of these people wound up being dragged to California, too. And so, as I say in that footnote, there are people who consider themselves to be African-American, who are really Melanesians. They may not realize, because you know, we all look the same. And by the way, the Fiji in the South Seas, a very lovely country, the language, the indigenous language of Fiji, if you do sort of linguistic research, it's very similar to many East African languages, which suggests that there was this migration from East Africa to the South Seas that is manifested even today in the language of the Fijian people. And certainly, they look like yourself and myself. As a matter of fact, when I was out in Fiji, I noticed many of the women were wearing Afros. And I was thinking, Johnson Products of Chicago, if they came out here, you know, advertising campaign, they get all these sisters straight in there and make a fortune. Then I did a couple books on Asian. And one is called Race War, White Supremacy and the Japanese Attack on the British Empire. One of the points that I try to make there is that many of the black nationalist groups of the 1930s were very pro-Tokyo. That's where the concept of the Asiatic black man comes from. You hear a lot of these rappers talk about the Asiatic black man. I'm not sure if they recognize that that is straight from 1930s discourse, straight from 1930s conversation when a lot of the black nationalists were pro-Tokyo. And not only that, but if you look before 1941, the first few decades of the 20th century, most of the black leaders and intellectuals of that time, Du Bois, Booker T. Washington, Marcus Garvey, they may have had differences between and amongst themselves, but strikingly enough, many of them all had positive things to say about Japan, because from their point of view, the very existence of Japan helped to disprove the point that was being made by the white supremacists, which was that only people, as used to be said, of pure European descent could build advanced societies. And at the same time, you had the nationalist forces in Tokyo who were making overtures to the black American population. In fact, I'm working on a new book now entitled Facing the Rising Sun, which you may recall is both a line from the so-called Negro National Anthem, and also the rising sun is a Japanese symbol. And Facing the Rising Sun, black nationalism in Japan, black nationalism in Japan between the two wars. And I've already looked at the transcripts of the trial of Elijah Poole, Elijah Muhammad, you might recall 1942, he was convicted along with a number of leaders of the organization then called the Allah Temple of Islam, now called the Nation of Islam, because of their pro-Tokyo sentiments. There are transcripts all over the country of these trials. They basically rolled up all the nationalists because of their pro-Tokyo sentiments after World War II erupted. And just as a footnote, appropriately enough, this is how the research works. I mean, you try to look at as much as possible as primary sources, you know, letters, diaries, court transcripts in particular, because as you know, people do tend to fib for whatever reason. But at least with regard to a court transcript, people swear under the penalty of perjury to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help me God. And hopefully that weighs on their mind as they're talking. So you know, I'm looking at this with the aim of writing this new book on the black nationalists and Japan. Then I did this book on India, End of Empires, published about 5 or 6 years ago. As you know, Martin Luther King Jr. was very deeply influenced by Mahatma Gandhi of India, the whole concept of passive resistance, which was utilized by the civil rights demonstrators in the 1950s and the 1960s. That's a relationship that stretches back decades. There was a very close relationship between South Asians and black Americans. This is also reflected, I would say, in the transmission of Islam into black American communities. There are many transmission belts with regard to Islam in black American communities. One is, of course, many of the Africans were brought here from Muslims, as reflected in the fact that in certain archives you can find the enslaved population writing in Arabic, for example. And then, of course, at the end of the 19th century, beginning of the 20th century, you had a significant migration from South Asia, particularly South Asian Muslims. And the Ahmadiyya sect, quote unquote, of Islam in particular came into black American communities, not least because it was felt it was a cheaper place to reside in the United States. And there are some striking parallels between the former Allah Temple of Islam and Ahmadiyya, for example, which is one of the things that not only a point that I made, but other scholars have made. And it's something that, however, that we need to go into a bit more deeply for future research. Then, as Professor Carr suggested, that these books on Africa, one on Kenya, which is suggested is obviously of relevance given the fact that the person occupying the White House is of partial Kenyan descent, but also because of these close ties that existed between East Africa in black Americans, particularly in the 1950s and 1960s, because there was a parallel between the settler state, the European settler state was set up in Nairobi, and the European settler state was set up in North America. You had founders of the settler state in Nairobi who were related to founders of the settler state here in North America. Some of the wealthiest settlers in Kenya 100 years ago were Euro-Americans, in fact. You had, and then of course, if you look at some of our contemporary discourse, I noticed that Alfred Burks was talking about some of the ideas of this organization. And if you look at the relationship of black Americans to Swahili, within the language, now, it's well understood that significantly most of us can trace our ancestry to West Africa, particularly from the Bulge near Senegal down to Angola. But as I point out in my book on Brazil, the U.S. slave owners, who of course after they threw out the British and took over the slave trade, as Britain moved towards abolition, and then Britain set up a maritime picket line to keep the slave traders out, so the U.S. slave traders simply went around the Cape to East Africa and started kidnapping Africans there. And so a significant percentage of the African-American population, meaning not only North America, but Brazil and the Caribbean as well, really traced their roots to Mozambique, for example, and traced their roots to Zanzibar, which used to be the Walmart of the slave trade, because that's where enslaved peoples, Africans, were brought from in the interior, Congo, Mozambique, etc., and then sort of sent out to the Arab world, to Brazil, etc. And I think that this fascination with Swahili, in many ways, it reflects the fascination with Kenya. Of course, Swahili being not only spoken in Kenya, but Tanzania, Uganda as well. Then I did this book on Zimbabwe, and as I've already indicated, that's all I won't dwell too much on it there. There are so many parallels between Rhodesia and the United States. I think in my book, I only touched the surface. And I think there needs to be more scholarship on this particular relationship. Once again, some of the founders of that settler state in South Central Africa were related to founders of the settler state here in North America. As I point out in that Zimbabwe book, when the Rhodesians were fighting to forestall African liberation, you had hundreds, perhaps thousands of Euro-Americans who signed up to fight the Africans. Many of them are now dead and buried in Zimbabwe. That's because they saw a resonance with regard to that settler state, just as you had many Africans and African Americans who were in solidarity with the Zimbabwe struggle. I've done a number of books that implicate Europe, the Negro Comrades book, which I'll talk about shortly, but also a number of these books that deal with socialists and communists. Professor Carr mentioned the William Patterson book, but you could say the same thing about Du Bois, Ben Davis, Civil Rights Congress. I think that's important because in terms of the external influence that shapes developments here, it's not only how we, black people, have tried to utilize international pressure to change our situation here, which is something we've lost sight of, as illustrated by my hypothetical about Vladimir Putin coming here and wanting to meet about Trayvon Martin. But as well, if you want to understand what's called a welfare state in the United States, that is to say, Social Security, unemployment compensation, even federal aid to higher education, I would assume an issue of interest to many of you, that those items which are on the chopping block as we speak, you notice that they just tried to cut back on food stamps yesterday, which is part of the so-called welfare state. The initiation of the welfare state in the United States is basically in the 1930s, and largely it's driven by fear in Washington that many U.S. nationals would be drawn to the socialist experiment that was taking place in Europe. And so in order to compete with that experiment, the United States moved towards social welfare measures itself, such as the ones I've already enumerated. But now the socialist experiment has collapsed, and surprise, surprise, the social welfare measures are now on the chopping block. Not only in the United States, it's a worldwide phenomenon. Even a welfare state like in good standing, like the Netherlands. They're talking about getting rid of a lot of their social welfare programs too. And in order to keep those programs, it's really going to take an uphill struggle. So now I'm going to talk about, everybody has a cover. If there are any extras, you can just pass them back. This is this book. I have to say, every time I look at this cover, I sort of crack up. Not that I'm not a humanitarian, but I mean, look at the slave owner who's about to be massacred. Look at his face. He's obviously in jeopardy. I'll just speak briefly about this book, because I've already foreshadowed it. I've already foreshadowed it by suggesting that it's a book that tries to suggest that the foundation of the United States was not a great leap forward for humanity, but in many ways was a great leap backwards. That in many ways it was the proclamation of the first apartheid state. That the Bill of Rights that were enshrined in the Constitution, and of course after the Constitution, as you know, was ratified, they were amendments, that it's improper to see that in many ways as a template that can be extended to the rest of us, unless you see the rights that were granted to Europeans and apartheid South Africa as a template that can be easily extended to the Africans, that in many ways it was combat pay. That is to say that the settlers, after they expelled London, the British, they had a problem because in many precincts in the colonies, the former 13 colonies, they were outnumbered by rebellious, rambunctious Africans and indigenous peoples. So how do you attract individuals to a combat zone? Well, of course, you promise them they can have land taken from the indigenous, and you can be stocked by Africans. And then you promise them a complement of rights, of democratic rights. These are enticements and inducements. I also say in this book that you can't understand how the United States came to be formed unless you understand what was going on in the Caribbean. Part of the problem with these books about the United States is that they usually start the story around 1776. You have to go back further. So I start my story in the 17th century, 100 years before 1776. When you have many of the European settlers being chased out of the Caribbean because they're outnumbered wildly as they're trying to enslave the Africans, they come to the mainland. Then the turning point with regard to the African slave trade and a world historic defeat for African peoples takes place in 1688 with the so-called Glorious Revolution in London, in England, I should say, which leads to a reduction of the power of the monarchy and a step forward in the power and influence of the merchant class. What happens is that the Royal African Company, which theretofore had been under the thumb of the monarchy, the king, it's opened up. Free trade to Africans is the title of the chapter. In other words, those burdensome government regulations are removed, and free trade descends in terms of the African slave trade. And as they often say on CNBC, the animal spirits of the merchants were unleashed. And they descend upon Africa like maniacal crazed bees and begin to kidnap Africans and drive them across the Atlantic. But this exacerbates their problem because that's bringing them to the Caribbean. And until the middle of the 18th century, the Caribbean was generating more profit for London than the North American mainland. And this leads to all these slave revolts, liquidation plots in Antigua and Jamaica in particular. In the 1730s, the British almost run out of Jamaica by what we call the Maroons. These are the Africans who flee and set up their own communities, particularly in the mountains. And so this leads to many of the settlers moving to the mainland. The problem there is that Florida was under Spanish control longer than it's been under U.S. control. Spanish control from the early 1500s up until 1821 in the United States. And the Spanish were more heavily dependent upon African soldiers than the British. Now the British say, because of their religious biases, but this is because the Spanish are Catholics, many of the men are going into priesthood, they're not allowed to procreate, and therefore they have a demographic crisis, and so they have to recruit more Africans to fight. But then there is also a national question, in the sense that you might have noticed just a few days ago, Catalonia, the most industrial region of Spain, which is now imbued with a certain kind of secessionism, there was a major demonstration. And this was taking place 300 years ago as well. And so the Catalonians were not seen as necessarily reliable soldiers, so they had to rely upon Africans as well. I should also say the British had the same problem with regard to the Irish and the Scottish. Scotland only becomes part of the UK, United Kingdom, Great Britain, in 1707, and there's an independence movement in Scotland, too, as you know, that may lead to Scotland independent. So the Spanish are always sending these Negro soldiers over to South Carolina to massacre, plunder, pillage. Stonewall's Revolt, 1739 in South Carolina. This is something a lot of the historians. That's another thing about male feet. That's why the good news is that a lot of U.S. history has to be rewritten, which should open up a lot of jobs for scholars. The bad news is the United States is in a crisis, and I'm not sure if the Treasury will be there to employ the scholars. But anyway, you look at a lot of these histories, and they don't even mention that Stonewall's Revolt is largely assisted by the Spanish. The Negroes in Spanish Florida coming from St. Augustine, which builds itself as the longest settlement in North America. That's what the tourist books say. And interestingly enough, a lot of the Africans in South Carolina, as the European settlers are saying in South Carolina at the time, a lot of the Africans enslaved are Angolans. And many of them speak Portuguese, which is similar to Spanish. Many of them are Catholic, like the Spanish are. Many of them come from Angola, which up to virtually this very day has had a long history of warfare. And so they're used to fighting. And so what happens is this leads to a war between Britain and Spain to kick the Spanish out of Florida, which largely succeeds. But the settlers then go behind the backs of the British, cut a deal with the Spanish against Britain. They do the same thing with the French, because the French were sending Negroes down from Canada, Quebec. Indeed, the slave revolt in New York City, 1741, has French and Spanish fingerprints, just like Stonewall's Revolt has Spanish fingerprints. And so then the settlers, after the British kicked the French out of Quebec, still is an unsettled situation there today, as you know, and then they kicked the Spanish out of Florida, but then the settlers, those crafty devils, they then go behind the backs of London, cut a deal with the Spanish and the French, kick the British out of North America, and there you have the United States of America. So this is what this book is about. And then, the book that's out on the table, now I'm winding up, I'll be ending shortly. You can pass those back. Negro Comrades of the Crown, African Americans of the British Empire fight the United States before emancipation. So, fine, the United States is settled. And, of course, the British are still licking their wounds about being kicked out by the settlers. And the British are also moving towards abolitionism, which is already noted was one of the reasons why they get kicked out in the first place. And so the African Americans, the U.S. Negroes, begin to cut a deal with London, against the settlers. And it culminates, and I hope this is marked in the city of Washington, August 1814. You all have time to prepare for the anniversary, perhaps even a mini conference, although Congress may not smile upon this if we try to cut your funding. Because in August 1814, the Negroes, the enslaved population of the British, basically sacked Washington, D.C., burned down the White House, sent President James Madison and his garrulous spouse, Dolly, fleeing into the night, one step ahead of the posse. And then, after that happens, many of the black people from who burned down Washington then are assisted by the British. They move to Trinidad, where their descendants still reside. As a matter of fact, Ackman was just telling me that Patrick Manning, a former prime minister of Trinidad and Tobago was married to one of these former U.S. Negroes who set up this community in Trinidad and Tobago. They moved to Bermuda, they moved to Nova Scotia, etc. And so I could go into more detail about this book, but it's all outside. And the picture is of, it's interesting. These black people in the United States, they're always trying to flee U.S. jurisdiction. So they move to what is now the state of Washington. Actually, they move to California. Let's start with California. And as you know, in the 1840s, the United States basically dismembers Mexico and takes over California, amongst other territories. And so these U.S. Negroes thought that they had moved to Mexico. They wound up being under the stars and stripes nonetheless. And so, you know, the white supremacist Yankees show up, and it's the usual harassment, persecution, etc. So they decide to move north to British Columbia. I don't know if you've ever been to British Columbia. Vancouver, Victoria, you know, it's a very pleasant community. And interestingly enough, the governor of British Columbia is a man of color with roots in what is now Guyana. You know, the British have this major empire and a small population, so like the Spanish, they have to rely more heavily on peoples of color than the model of development in the United States, which is based on the model of whiteness, where you bring people from the Atlantic to the Urals and then amalgamate them into this new population that's called white. And so the United States, one of its historic ambitions has been to take over Canada. And as I point out in this book, that one of the reasons the United States was not able to take over Canada is because the Negroes fled there, and finally they decided, look, we're tired of moving to these places trying to escape U.S. jurisdiction, then they come in and take over, so we're going to make a stand here. And one of the reasons today why Canada is still an independent country is because of these former U.S. Negroes who moved there and then take up guns to keep the United States out. And then finally, this is a book that should be out any day. As I said, these publishers, they are very 19th century friends. So they told me about the time I came to Washington that this would be out, but you know, especially with these university presses, I mean, they get subsidies, so they're not driven by the agony of the marketplace, because they get government subsidies, and so they tend to slow them down. Now, this book extends this theme of the hidden history of black internationalism. William Patterson, part of his family was from the state of Virginia, right across the river. Part of his family was from St. Vincent in the Caribbean. Some of you may know about the history of St. Vincent and about their heroic struggles against the British and the French, which leads to the deportation of many of the Africans to Central America, where they become part of a newly created community called the Garifuna, which you may be familiar with. We have this very rich musical tradition of what is now Belize and Honduras in particular. So he's born in San Francisco circa 1890, dies in 1980. But he was a lawyer, and his contribution to internationalism was not only leading the defense of the Scottsboro Nine. You may recall the Scottsboro Nine, the nine youth in Alabama, circa 1930, 1931, who were accused falsely of sexual molestation of two-year-old American women. An international campaign erupts that William Patterson helps to generate and coordinate that leads to their freedom. Not only leads to their freedom, but leads to legal protections for not only black Americans, but for people in general in the United States with regard to trial by jury and all the rest. But William Patterson also went to Moscow after the Bolshevik Revolution of 1917 in Russia, and in fact spoke Russian and was trained there as a revolutionary to come back to the United States and help to radicalize the U.S. population, radicalize the black population, but in more than that, to push for basic democratic rights, because it was always seen as a two-front struggle to have larger goals of extending, shall we say, the welfare state, Social Security, unemployment compensation, federal aid to higher education, all the rest, on the other hand, to struggle day to day against lynching, against mob violence, for the right to vote, which I was about to say was not guaranteed until the Voting Rights Act of 1965, until I just recalled that they gutted it just a few months ago, and these other basic democratic protections. So he was a professional revolutionary who was struggling for socialism. And then in the latter part of his life, he coordinated the Angela Davis campaign. You may recall Angela Davis, the former professor at UCLA, who was accused, facing three death penalty counts. I guess they've been killed three times. She had been convicted for supposedly helping a jailbreak. These prisoners on trial in Marin County, California, just north of San Francisco, are assisted by some Confederates in taking the jury hostage, taking the judge hostage, but they're all slain on the scene. Some of her guns are used because she felt under threat at UCLA because of hate mail. And Patterson leads the defense, which is also another international defense. When you see someone like the Scottsboro Nine or Angela Davis basically ultimately going free, it's not usually by happenstance in a country like this. It's usually because of the two themes that I began with some moments ago. Number one, people here struggling, organizing, having meetings, having demonstrations, going on the radio, circulating petitions, etc. And then the other prong is doing this not only domestically but globally, reaching out across the oceans, reaching southward, reaching northward, recognizing that there is a very strong and mass right-wing movement in the United States of America, and that historically, in order to countervail and counterweigh that movement, you had to lengthen the battlefield and bring in people from outside the United States to weigh in. Oh, sorry, there are a couple more points.
And you can call us ubiquity, we're standing forever like a tree. Call us ubiquity.